Andy, my dude, have you heard of the magical website builder known as Squarespace?
Ugh, not another Squarespace ad. I feel like every podcast is sponsored by them.
Hey, don't knock it till you try it. Yes, okay, it is overhyped. But actually, it lives up to the hype. Squarespace is like a website fairy godmother. With a click of a button, your site transforms into a beautiful masterpiece.
A website fairy godmother? That sounds interesting. What makes it so magical?
Well, for starters, those slick templates make anyone look like a professional web designer. Pick one, customize the colors and fonts to match your brand, and voila. Plus, the drag and drop fluid engine is so easy, your grandma could build a site on Squarespace.
Well, she did knit me a lovely scarf last Christmas. Maybe website design is next.
Exactly. And when you're ready to sell your Nana's handmade scarves online, Squarespace has built-in e-commerce. Add a store with one click. Get flexible payment options. Then watch those sales roll in. And when she wants to teach others her steezy scarf skills, Squarespace's new courses feature is just the ticket. Nana can set up her curriculum and enrollments and payments in a snap and become the next e-knitting influencer.
Oh, wow, you really sold me with the grandma angle. Sign me up for that free trial.
Just go to thenextreel.com/Squarespace and transform your site into a beautiful Squarespace masterpiece.
Well, thanks, Pete. Even though it's overhyped, Squarespace actually sounds perfect for Nana's site's needs. Appreciate the warning on the ads, though. I'll brace myself next time I listen to a podcast.
Anytime. Let me know if you need any help getting that site up and running.
It's hard to believe that we've been having in-depth weekly conversations about movies since 2011.
So many great conversations over the years about so many great movies. All that said, producing this show week after week requires a ton of work behind the scenes.
Becoming a Next Reel member gives you access to all sorts of additional and exclusive content. Plus, you're helping us keep the lights on. Just head to thenextreel.com/membership, where you can learn more about becoming a member, which costs a measly $5 a month, practically the same as one fancy coffee drink. And you get so much more.
Every month, we record a bonus episode exclusively for members. Those episodes cover movies from whatever series we're covering at the moment, or add to previous series.
Some movies we've covered that only members get to hear us discuss include The Blues Brothers,
The Russia House,
Naked Lunch,
Independence Day,
The Hot Rock,
and Relic, the better one. Plus, members get to vote on what we're going to discuss for those episodes.
We also record additional pre- and post-show content in regular episodes that only members get to hear.
Like conversations about similarly themed movies.
And answering listener questions from our live member chat.
Speaking of our live member chat, we record almost all of our episodes in Discord, where members can chat right along with us live.
Members get access to other members-only channels in our Discord community as well. On top of all that, members get all episodes a full week earlier than everyone else in a private Next Reel feed just for them that includes all the shows in the Next Reel family. The Next Reel, The Film Board,
Movies We Like, Sitting in the Dark, and more new projects on the way.
To top it all off, members don't have to listen to ads. We've already eliminated those annoying, dynamically inserted ads that, let's face it, we all hate it.
We are listening to you.
We love podcasting for a living, and those ads help to pay the bills. Now, we're counting on you, dear listener.
We promise we aren't going back to those terrible, dynamically inserted ads that don't relate to us at all. All we ask is that you consider supporting the Next Reel family of podcasts with a membership.
Again, it's $5 per month or $55 per year. Just head to thenextreel.com/membership.
Thenextreel.com/membership. Get your access to early, ad-free episodes with bonus content, member bonus episodes, and access to member channels and live streams in Discord by signing up today.
Welcome to the Next Reel's Movies We Like, part of the True Story FM Entertainment Network. I'm Andy Nelson. That over there is Pete Wright.
Hi, Andy.
On today's episode, we have invited screenwriter and graphic artist Todd Alcott to talk about Bambi, a movie he likes. Hey, Todd.
Hey.
We are thrilled to have you joining us here to have this conversation about a wonderful, wonderful film, something that I've grown up with. I think it's fair to say that considering the way that Disney releases movies, it's something we've all grown up with over the years. Bambi from 1942. Before we jump into the movie, though, let's talk a little bit about you and the work that you've done. So you're a screenwriter.
I was the first writer on Ants, and a lot of my stuff ended up in the movie. I got credit. There's other movies that I worked on that I don't have a credit on, and there's other movies I have a credit on that my stuff isn't in there anymore. But that's the way the screenwriting business goes. But I can genuinely say, yes, I was there for Ants, and I wrote that script, and the Weitz brothers came on, and they did a great job, and the movie came out great, and then it made money, and everyone was happy.
Well, that's really the biggest question that I had, and you already answered it. Are you happy with the movie as it ended up with, you know, whatever combination of your stuff and their stuff left?
Oh, it was very strange. I went to see it opening day, and it was a matinee, and it was full of kids, and it was very strange because at the same time that I was working on Ants, I was also working on an adaptation of The Merchant of Venice. That sounds weird, I know. But I was a playwright at the same time. And The Merchant of Venice, I found, was about a man, this merchant, Antonio, who's not content with Venetian society. And the play, in a way, is about, well, how does he respond to this corrupt society? Then that project was done, and I was immediately working on Ants. And then 2.5 years later, the movie comes out, and I'm watching it in the theater, and I'm like, oh, this is another story about this individual's response to a corrupt society and how his initial response is to, well, let's get out of here. I'm gonna marry the princess, and I'm gonna move out of here and find some other place to live. And then he decides, oh, well, no, the society is still corrupt, and I still belong to it. I have to go back and fix it. And that's the difference between Ants and The Merchant of Venice. And in The Merchant of Venice, they say, "The hell with Venice. We're gonna go live here I forget the name of the place they go live in, but they abandon the place." Anyway, but it was very strange because the movie Ants, it's about genocide. And I was watching the third act of the piece, and I'm like, huh, it's a kid's movie about genocide. It's weird that they let me do that.
Yeah, right. That Jeffrey Katzenberg always looking to do something to stand out from Disney, right?
Weirdly progressive, I guess.
Yeah, it's funny. There's a line, I can't remember if I wrote it or not, but there's a line towards the end, and it's like, you know, it's just sort of a boy meets girl, boy falls in love, boy and girl change the underlying social order of the society. Everyone's happily ever after. Anyway. But that was a real experience. It was very strange how I got the job because I had never written an animated movie before, and Nina Jacobson, who was the executive in charge of the project at DreamWorks, had read one of my scripts, and she called me up and asked me if I wanted to write this animated movie about talking ants. And I remember I was living in New York, and I was sitting there on my computer, and I was thinking, ah, geez, oh, man. Oh, no, I've never written an animated movie before. I don't know if I'm really interested in animation. I suppose if I was going to write an animated movie, it might as well be for the guy who made The Lion King. What am I thinking? Yes, of course, I will write, your talking ant movie. So it was a huge opportunity presented to me, and it was the easiest job I've ever gotten. It was crazy that she just called me up and asked me to do it, and I said yes, and that was the process.
Wow.
And that's not how most scripts get written these days.
Yeah.
But slightly related question. This, you know, it comes up often where you have movies, you have a big movie that comes out, and then there's another movie that just like it, that happens to hit at the same time. And here, of course, it's hard to talk about Ants and not talk about A Bug's Life. How does that hit you as the writer of one of these? Did you even notice or care?
Well, DreamWorks certainly knew that A Bug's Life was coming out. And in fact, I felt bad because their movie, Pixar's movie, was originally just called Bugs. And and everyone at DreamWorks knew it was coming out. And when they asked me to write this movie about ants, I just so that I could identify the project I was working on in my own files, I just called it Ants with an S. And that's the title that stuck. And somewhere in the marketing process, they said, let's change it to a Z. And I feel bad that Pixar had to change the name of their movie, but they had to change it because of just my little placeholder title of Ants.
Wow.
Isn't that funny?
But I feel like the movies are very different. But I will say that the reason that they both came out at the same time is because the way that computer animation had developed up till then, you know, toys, that's a perfect example of something that will look good computer animated because mm-hmm. there's limited movement and everything is very stiff and that all works.
Lots of straight lines.
Lots of straight lines, lots of solid objects that bump into each other. And if you see early Pixar movies like Tin Toy, you'll see the weird monstrous robotic baby that has its that has its diaper that's like made out of concrete or something. It doesn't have any softness to it at all. And so it seemed to me that, well, the next obvious thing is insects. You would make a movie about insects and
something with an exoskeleton, right? That makes
something
sense.
That's also hard and stiff and doesn't, but you know, the ants is in the Guinness Book of World Records as the first movie to have computer generated water. Yeah.
Wow.
So that was a program that the people at the animation company, that was another weird thing I had been working in an office at DreamWorks for months writing treatment after treatment after treatment for this movie that didn't have a title or a story or anything else. And then one day I pick up Variety in the lobby and the headline is that DreamWorks has spent $40 million on an animation company to make the movie that I've been sitting in the office writing treatments for. And I'm like, whoa, okay. And then wow. The next thing I know, I'm getting in David Geffen's private jet to fly to Palo Alto to meet the people who are making the movie that I'm writing. And it was all very strange for me. I was an experimental playwright in New York at the time. So it was all very weird for me too. And that's a whole other story. If you ever want to talk about ants for an hour,
no kidding.
But yeah, it was quite an experience, one that I'm awfully glad to have had.
Absolutely. No, that's great. Before we jump into Bambi, because I mean, that's why we're here, I do just want to check. I wanted to find out, because I do see also that you have a credit as the mailroom screamer in the Hudsucker proxy.
The Hudsucker proxy, yes.
Oh, my goodness.
a long time ago in New York, I was best known as a performance artist. This is in the early 90s. I did these monologue pieces where I would get up on stage and act crazy for a few minutes. The Coen brothers found out about that somehow through their casting agent, Donna Isaacson. And she brought me in to read. Are you familiar with Hudsucker?
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Oh, yes.
So I was up for the part of the elevator boy, the elevator gnat, Buzz.
Sure.
I came in and I auditioned for them and I amped everything up to 11 and I did the thing as fast as I could and I put in as many inflections as I could and I made it as big and as comical as I could. This was all at the casting director's direction. I'm pleased to say that I actually made Ethan Coen fall over laughing.
Hey.
So that was another big day for me that he was clutching his sides and falling over.
Nice.
I was like, well, that went well. I don't think I'll get it. And I didn't get it. But they liked me enough that they gave me a one-line part and flew me to Wilmington to be in the movie. And I was there with Richard Schiff, who become a beloved character actor. He was another one of the screamers. It was an incredible set. That mailroom set was absolutely amazing. It was like 100 yards long on the floor of this abandoned car floor mat factory in Wilmington. And and I walked in, and oh man, you wouldn't believe it. Like the pillars on the set that were supposed to be in the basement of a skyscraper, and the pillars looked exactly like cement that had been painted and repainted and dried out and become moist and dried out again, so that the paint was like, it was like wrinkled and sagging in places. And I was like, oh my God, these cement pillars look so great. And I touched one and I realized that, well, of course it's plywood.
Yeah.
And but you had to actually touch it to realize that it wasn't damp cement. And when you look up and you realize, oh, it ends 20 feet in the air.
Right. Not under a ceiling.
The sets on that thing are just amazing. And they had to come and get me a couple of times because I wandered off to look at the other sets. There was this elevator set. They had this incredible cherry wood finish to it. And there were these gleaming brass fixtures. And I was like, wow, that brass looks incredible. It too was painted plywood. I couldn't believe it. Anyway.
The art of the production design.
Fantastic.
And I believe that's Dennis Gassner. I could be wrong, but incredible production designer. And I worked with him on a Wonder Woman project that didn't happen, but incredible talent.
Well, just, I mean, that's so much fun to just be involved in projects like that with people who are just so incredibly creative. You know, it just kind of pours off the screen of all of their projects.
I mean, I'm a huge Coen Brothers fan anyway. So, but yeah, it's always nice to remember, oh yeah, I'm actually in one of their movies.
And one of my favorite ones. Oh my goodness, I love Hudsucker so much.
Hey, yeah, that's great. 6 Degrees.
And I'm also in 6 Degrees of Separation, oddly enough.
Oh, hey, look at that.
I have one
line. Literally 6 Degrees.
Yeah, I don't have a line in 6 Degrees of Separation. I had a line, and they changed the blocking at the last minute and gave it to somebody else.
Ah.
So the back of my head is in 6 Degrees of Separation.
I'll take it.
But it's there.
But it's there.
Well, speaking of just like incredibly creative people and talented people, let's talk about this film that Walt Disney put together, Bambi.
Yeah.
From 1942.
Love is a song that never ends. Life may be swift and fleeting.
Yeah, let's start a little bit about just like, you know, first time seeing it and getting a sense of, you know, where you were as a child seeing it for the first time and how you kind of were introduced to this story.
Well, it's crazy because I can literally mark the stages of my development based on viewings of Bambi. And they say that 7 is the age of reason. And I'm sure I had been to movies before. I'm sure that I had seen Snow White. Back then, Disney released their movies every 7 years because there was literally a new audience every 7 years. People who were not born before, for them, it's like a new movie. I certainly don't remember going to see Bambi and thinking, oh, this looks decades old. It was just a movie to me. And, you know, it's absolutely gorgeous to look at. I was just watching it again this morning, and that opening sequence with the forest and everything, and the multi-plane camera and all of that stuff is just so gorgeously rendered. And it's impossible to, you know, when you think of how they would do that kind of sequence today, I can't see how it would be more atmospheric and more evocative of this kind of primeval forest. But in any case, so I was 7 years old, and I think my parents were not there. I had older siblings, so they would kind of send us to the movies all at once. I had heard that Bambi's mother died, but I didn't know what that meant or anything like that. And that part of the movie didn't bother me so much. It was traumatic, of course, because it's meant to be, and it's hugely effective. It's still very effective, and even better is the pheasants who are hiding from the hunter, and there's the one who's panicking. No, I can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
Oh
yeah.
My God.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
But what I remember at 7 was at the end of the movie, the new fawns are born, and the camera tilts up to look, and there's Bambi and his father standing on the bluff where we saw his father at the beginning of the movie. And now Bambi's there, and his father is there with him, and his father slowly turns and walks away, and I had no idea. I'm seven. I have no idea what that means, but I knew that I had seen something incredibly profound, and I remember being so disturbed by it and taking a shower after the movie, after I got home. And I remember sitting curled up in a ball, crouching on the floor of the bathroom, looking at the tile, thinking,
wow,
what was that? What happened? What was that movie about? I don't understand. And then it came out 7 years later, and I went to see it again. This is all before home video, of course.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
You couldn't watch a movie anytime you wanted. You had to go see it in a theater. I enjoyed it at 14, and then I saw it again at 21, and I was like, yeah, this is nice. It's really well done. Didn't particularly affect me. And then in 19, I think it was 88, whatever year Scrooged came out, it was released again.
Yeah, 88.
And it was Christmas Day or Christmas Eve or something. And I was working, I managed movie theaters in New York. And so I got to see all my movies for free. So I spent my day going to see movies. And there was a twin theater that was showing Scrooged and a re-release of Bambi. And I watched Scrooged, which is also has a very emotional ending. And so raw from my first viewing of Scrooged, I went into the next theater to watch Bambi, and the credits started, and I was like, oh, I'm checking in with an old friend. Let's see how Bambi this year.
Yeah.
And there's all of the animals, and they're all excited about something, and they're all going to, the new prince has been born. And I'm like, oh, that's interesting. Everyone's excited about this new prince. Let's go see what the new prince is doing. And everyone rushes, and there's Bambi, and he's just a little baby, and he's just been born, and he looks up, and everyone's staring at him, and everyone is waiting for him to do something. And I was alone in the theater. It was Christmas Eve. No one was going to see Bambi. And I remember it was like I had just been electrocuted. I went, oh my God, this movie isn't about a deer at all. And it had never occurred to me that suddenly I realized this movie is about me. and it's like you're born and everyone's looking at you and you're supposed to do something, and it's terrifying. And the owl, Thumper is there making fun of him. Oh, he's pretty wobbly, isn't he?
Right.
Like, well, geez, he was just born, and there's people already criticizing his game.
Oh my God, yeah. For sure. And so like subversive. Watching it as a kid, you could totally see, oh, his Thumper is so cute. Watching it as an adult, Thumper's kind of a dick. Really? You want to just say, Thumper, hold your own. Like, get it. Move along, well, man.
And it's funny because, everyone makes fun of Bambi. Feline makes fun of Bambi. Flower does not.
Right.
And I was watching it again this morning, and I was looking at Thumper, and I'm like, you know, it's funny. He's not gay. Flower isn't gay, but he is effeminate, and he likes flowers. Why does he like flowers? Because Bambi put that into his head, that it's okay for a boy to like flowers. And I just loved that Flower is like, I'm perfectly happy. I'm going to like flowers, and then I'm going to grow up, and I'm going to mate with a girl skunk, and that'll be who I am. And I'm Flower the skunk, and I'm okay with that. I like who I am. Anyway, I'm always very charmed by Flower and his how he's kind of a outlier in this weird forest dichotomy where mothers are attentive and fathers are completely
absentee.
Completely
absentee father. And I think that's the other piece that really feels so subversive and progressive about this movie, that here we are largely, this team of largely men making this movie that deals so deeply with identity and these values of relationships that we hold so core to our own being. And yet it's taken decades to be able to talk about these things more publicly. And here was Bambi in the 40s that was already trying to poke at some of these ideological, like, issues of ideological restraint. I think it's fascinating.
No, it's fascinating. And so while I was working on Ants, Jeffrey Katzenberg, who was running the studio at the time, you know, he worked at Disney and made The Little Mermaid and The Lion King and Beauty and the Beast and that whole block of the Disney Renaissance. And he said, I've seen Walt's boards for Snow White. It's 10 beats in the first act, 10 beats in the second act, 4 beats in the third act. And so that's how I'm going to make movies. And if you, certainly The Lion King follows that. It's got this, Lion King has this 50 minute first act, which, I mean, it doesn't happen anymore. And then it has like a 10 minute second act and then like a 10 minute third act. So Bambi has this very long first act, everything up until Bambi's mother's death. Then it has this very brief second act, maybe. And then the third act, like the fire, it all kinds of flows like a river. And there's only the one demarcated act break where Bambi's mother is dead and Bambi has to go wander in the woods with his father in the wintertime.
Which is never illuminated for us, right? That is an interesting thing. It's just sort of a block out of his life is gone.
And apparently the Disney company made a sequel that tells us what happened in those months with his father. I don't want to see that. But to me, the Bambi is a movie that's literally about the mystery of life. What is life, and what are we doing here, and what's the point of any of this? So I'm working on Ants, and so I'm like, okay, well, I too will go back and study the old Walt Disney movies, and Bambi was at the top of my list. You folks, I don't know how many screenwriters you talk to, but there is this hard and fast rule in Hollywood screenwriting. What does the protagonist want? That is the entire movie. What does the protagonist want? What is he after? What stands in his way? Who is arrayed against him? And that is all a cinematic narrative is. The protagonist is in pursuit of a goal. Something is in his way. He has to overcome it. And he does or he doesn't. Whatever the case may be. And I'm watching Bambi and I'm like, there's nothing in there. There's absolutely nothing. The protagonist, he doesn't want to look like an idiot. That's about it. And it doesn't matter what he does. Everything makes him look like an idiot. Anything that he tries, it's like, bunnies, I'm going to hop like a bunny. And then he falls on a log and everyone laughs at him because he, an idiot. And the thing with the ice, again, Thumper is like, come on out onto the ice.
I know, yeah, Thumper's the worst. Thumper.
So Bambi, it's all about, there's this child, and he's always a child, he never grows up, who is constantly trying to figure out, well, how do I do this? What is life? What am I supposed to be doing? And every single time, it doesn't matter how small the beat is, every single time he thinks, I know what I'm supposed to do now. He does that thing, and then life changes the stakes. My favorite example is, so it's springtime, and everyone is Twitter-pated. Flower goes off with the girl skunk, and Thumper goes off with the girl rabbit, and Bambi stumbles upon Feline, and suddenly they're romping through clouds, and there's this wonderful, like, minute-long sequence of them hopping through the clouds, and then suddenly here comes this stag, this rival stag, who is like, aha, you found love, now I have to fight you. And it's like, right. What? I didn't ask for this. What are you talking about? And now he's got to fight this guy. And then the next thing you know, the freaking forest is on fire again. It's like, what? Bambi never catches a break. And I realized that there is this entire pageant of life that we watch him go through in 70 minutes with no plot whatsoever. It's just little scenes of the life in this creature, and he never learns. You know, Disney has quoted as saying, the reason my movies are successful is because everyone in the world is or has once been a child. And that is the subject of Bambi, because I don't know how other kids were, but that's certainly how I felt. It was always like, all right, well, I'm just getting used to this thing where I can feed and dress myself. Okay, wait, I have to go to school now? What? And then you get to school and there's all these other people there and there's all these rules and you're supposed to do things and you're supposed to know about things. And it never stops.
Well, yeah, and I think that's what's really interesting about this, because those transitions through our lives don't get easier. They just get different, right? They just transitioning to high school, transitioning to college, whatever, transitioning to adolescence, transitioning to Twitterpation. They're just different. They're not any, objectively not easier. And so, like, looking at how Bambi in, 1942 interprets those changes is a really interesting sort of reflection on the, you know, largely men constructing this universe, this like fantastical universe of woodland creatures that has the same cultural hierarchies that we're still largely dealing with.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. But the idea that, you know, at the end of the movie, now Bambi is the prince of the forest, but we've seen his entire experience, and it's like, well, what qualified his father?
Yeah, right. I know.
Right.
The thing
that he managed to live the longest?
He managed to live the longest. Bambi's mother says, because no other deer has lived half so long as him. So what does that mean? That means that when he walks into the meadow, everyone watches him to see if he's going to panic.
Yeah.
Because when he panics, that's the cue for everybody to panic.
Right.
And that's it. That's what he does. He has lived the longest because they say he has wisdom, but wisdom is just it's an elevated form of pattern recognition. Oh, the birds. The birds are doing mm-hmm. that. I have to watch out.
Right.
And so the deer who is best at recognizing those patterns of danger is the one who becomes the protector of the herd. But the fact that, like, the stags have absolutely nothing to do with their children.
Yeah.
They have nothing to do with their mates. The mates don't even, they, like, the father stops and says hi to Bambi, doesn't even say hi to his mother.
No. Just yeah, just walks away.
And then, but I love how at the end of the movie, first of all, Flower comes along and he turns off screen and says, come along, Bambi. And he's talking to his own son. So Flower's there with his son. And then Thumper is also there with his nine children or however many he has. So not all of the patterns completely remain. You know, Thumper's dad was absent as well. He apparently was there for, you know, breakfast to say, don't do this, do that instead.
Right.
But what he's doing all day, I have no idea. But yeah, I was completely blown away when I sat down as a screenwriter to go through the script beat by beat. Okay, what is the protagonist doing here? He's doing this. How does the world react? It makes fun of him. He screws up again. He masters this one. He masters walking, and they give him ice. You know, he masters the word bird, and then everyone laughs at him because he calls a butterfly a bird. And then he figures out, okay, so that's a butterfly. Oh, look, there's other butterflies. No, those are flowers. Oh, jeez, everything.
But you know what's so interesting about that, Todd, though? I watch it, and I think part of the reason Bambi doesn't make me finish watching it and feel absolutely desolate, like absolutely inconsolable,
right,
is because Bambi never really wavers in the face of ridicule, right? Like,
He doesn't
Bambi's
no, yeah.
He doesn't give up. Like it's he masters Bird and they're giving him other stuff and they're making fun of him and they're laughing, but he doesn't seem ever really shook by it, right? That when we first see him shook and then he sort of like we miss the grieving process is we made it, Mama, we made it, Mama, and Mama didn't make it. And that is a terrible thing. And then they mask all of the grief and he comes back with horns. Like most of the reason I think Bambi works and works as kind of a role model for kids is he's sort of unflappable.
Sure. But you know, it's funny when you think of that kind of protagonist in a kid's movie, it's always the, you know, the cocksure go-getter guy who's like, nope, that doesn't bother me. And Bambi is just, he's so much more passive. That's the thing that's really shocking about the screenplay is that he's not in pursuit of anything. If anything, he's like, he's trying to avoid everything. and it's, you mentioned how life continues to be surprising. As I get older, I'm beginning to look at people. There's people even older than me. And I begin to look at them and go and think, oh, all of those things that I think of as old people behavior, and I'm using my little fingers with air quotes here, to those people, that stuff is brand new too. It's like, oh, I just figured out what I'm going to do for retirement, and now I have a disease, you know? So it just, it never stops. This process of will I, you know, the people, you always like to joke about how, what do I want to do when I grow up? And it's like, well, it never really happens. You never really grow up. And I feel like, especially in the time that Bambi was made, I mean, it came out during World War II, but World War II hadn't happened while they were making it. Adulthood in that time was also this mysterious thing where you were a child. And childhood was a very different thing back then. You had children who were still working in factories. And the next thing you know, suddenly they're in war and they're going off to war. And then they come back from World War II and nobody talks about anything. You know, that's the greatest generation, right? That you go to war as a teenager and then you come back. And now you're a man and no one knows what any of that means. And the decision made is that we will never speak of this again.
Here is trauma. And here's how we live through trauma is we don't speak of it.
It's an interesting, like the exploration of that type of story, like it fits really well. Like you can see why it wasn't just a story about a family or something like that, but putting it in the natural world and we have these animals and we get to kind of experience this story with them as they're kind of living just the life of animals in the forest. I mean, it makes sense that it fits in that world. And for us watching it, we can go, okay, I can watch this story about this passive animal and these animals in the forest because that's where they are. It's very difficult to see how you can translate that same story into, I mean, as you're saying, in the world of screenwriting, like how do you translate that into a story of people? It's very difficult. Although I guess you could say, well, if you put it into something, you know, All Quiet on the Western Front sort of thing, or a war story, yeah, it's like, then, okay, I can see how you can see, like, these are these young people who have a vision of what life is and a vision of what war is, and then they're in it, and things are always different, and nothing's ever the same, and you never know, like, the rules are constantly changing. And so, I mean, it's a totally different type of story, but it seems like it would be very difficult to tell a story like Bambi in a world of people. And that's, I think, kind of an interesting element of it.
Exactly. Well, and the fact that the animation is so disarming and that you never stop being interested in what Bambi is doing or what any of the animals are doing. And I don't know why it works, but I don't know anyone who says, oh, I tried watching Bambi, it was boring. I don't know who could watch it and not at any point think, oh my God, that's what my childhood was like. Like it has to be this kind of universal thing. The only modern movie you were talking about, All Quiet on the Western Front, and I remember thinking a similar thing about Forrest Gump, that here's this movie, 2.5, 3 hours long, I can't remember. And apart from the love story with Jenny, Forrest doesn't want anything either. He kind of does things and things happen to him. And because of who he is, he gets through somehow and continues to flourish. Even things like that were happening at the time, Italian neorealism, like, has more plot than Bambi. It's crazy. It's crazy that that was that this. As we were talking about earlier, the movie didn't do well when it first came out. I don't know why. I don't think it was the plot, but or its lack of plot. But talk about a movie that benefited from aging and from a company being able to re-release it and re-release it until everyone who wanted to see it could see it.
Well, there's a benefit of the fact that so many of those early films, especially the ones where Walt really had a hand in, like you can just get a sense of that timeless quality that he was really striving for with them. Because, I mean, this film doesn't feel like any particular time. I mean, it could, like, these deer could be out in the forest right now. It just feels like such a story that has no specific time at all.
I think that's a really good point, Andy, but I also wonder, like, what are the constraints that would make this movie impossible to make now, particularly from the position of a screenwriter? Like this movie stops and luxuriates in its color and light. It doesn't just mask grief and absentee parents. It's an opera of color, and the score is incredible. But it's also not very long. It's what is it, an hour 14, something like that?
70 minutes.
70 minutes. Yeah. So, would it be possible to make a timeless movie like this from where you sit, Todd?
Not at the Disney studio. I mean, that's the crazy thing, is I wrote a little sketch once where Walt Disney is unfrozen and goes to the studio bearing his name and pitches a movie of the kind that he would make. And the executives are like, well, I don't understand.
Who is that guy?
Yeah. Wait a minute. So wait. So the deer, is there like an evil deer who's like the
first
and the evil deer wants to take over the world? Because the stakes have to be super high or else we're not going to make any money on this thing. No. It's just there's a deer and it's about him trying to make his way through life and he meets a girl and suddenly everything is different. And it's just about life and the way that people experience these inner. And also you have to remember, it's not just Disney. Everything, there was this whole period in the 90s where animated movies for children just became super antic and just stuffed full of plot. We remember the ones that were good, like Toy Story. But there were so many others that it was just like, we're going to have people making faces and it's going to be action all over the place. And just this sense of you can't bore the kids. And it's like the fact that Bambi is so quiet and so gentle, and you'll find moments, just tiny little things like, you know, the mouse at the beginning of the movie, he's waking up and he pulls a drop of dew off of a blade of grass and he rubs it on his face and that's how he washes his face. And the movie is filled with little gags like that. And it's even things like, so Bambi trips and falls and then he's splayed out on the ground and his tail flips up and Thumper's head comes out of his tail. And things like Flower, you know, the girl skunk kisses him and he becomes erect.
for lack of a better word, I was searching for one that I couldn't.
He flips end over end, and then he does this little thing where he parts his tail and looks out through the bush of his tail.
And let's not forget that fantastic shrug he gives Thumper and Bambi as they're walking away. Like, that's one of my favorite Flower moment in the whole film. Like, what are you going to do?
And those moments aren't part of the screenplay. That was another team of guys, and their entire existence at the studio was just coming up with those physical gags. So I remember going to see Snow White. I guess it would have been a few years earlier. I was very young. And the one moment I remember is there's the dance sequence at the dwarf's house, and Grumpy's playing the organ, and he does this little run up the keyboard, and the camera pans over all the little stops on the organ pipes going. And then the last one, the last stop opens, and another little pipe comes out, and there's a little bird nest on it, and a little bird pops out of the nest and goes, beep!
Right.
And as a 5-year-old, a 3-year-old, I can't even remember how old I was. I just went, oh my God, someone had to think of that, you know, someone had to think of it. And then someone had to go through this incredibly time consuming, elaborate process of animating it. And it goes by like that. And yet it's magic. Bambi is full of moments like that, that are endemic to the studio. And it's what Disney was kind of known for, was those little character moments. But the underlying story of Bambi is so gentle and so it's mind-boggling to me to have to see a movie with a protagonist that doesn't want anything.
The closest thing that I can think of in recent times would be something like, Hayao Miyazaki's My Neighbor Totoro or something along that line. Like that's kind of
a vibe.
Yeah. It's really kind of about just the sense of place, the sense of space, as far as those two kids and their summer with mom in the hospital. And it's hard for them, I think, to allow for that. And it's funny because I think it's less the screenwriters, more probably the studio heads are the ones saying, oh, the kids need action. They need all these beats. They need these punchlines and these jokes and this constant energy.
And the pop culture references.
Yeah, the pop culture references, absolutely. Without realizing that the kids also really revel in all those little details and those fine moments that are just sitting there and those sorts of things that they can absorb and think about and process. And like you talked about the little mouse washing his face with the drop of dew. Like that's something that I've always remembered. It has always been in my head from this film. And it's like, because probably I had time as a kid to like think about that and process that and really kind of absorb, is that how a mouse would really like wash its face? And like you're thinking about that sort of thing. And like that's what's so great about it. And you just don't get that space in the stories now.
Well, and there's the April showers sequence that stops the narrative cold, and it's just about things that look cool in the rain. And there's the Bellinate sequence where Bambi and Feline get together, and there's just these shots of the wind passing over the grass, and there's moments like that that strike me as that's what Disney was really about, was giving the audience presenting them with a world that they would recognize that's right outside their window that they'd never noticed before. And I go back to when Lady and the Tramp first came out on Blu-ray, and I was able to watch it on home video in a decent presentation. And first of all, the movie's beautifully animated, but mostly you watch Lady and the Tramp and it's like, oh my God, it's like I've never seen a dog before. and you're watching Lady and the Tramp, it's like, that's exactly what a dog is like. Oh my God, I love dogs. Dogs are fantastic. And you can see that the animators are thinking the same thing. The animators are like, I can't wait to show you these dogs. And if you watch that, I was watching Bambi this morning and I was like, wait a minute. So this is Bambi's shoulder, and then he's got this little upper arm, and then he's got this incredibly long forearm, and then he's got this wrist, and then his fingers are the whole bottom section of his. I'm like, oh my God, they sat and they watched deer, and deer are weird. I mean, the way that they walk.
Yeah, there's a lot of weird.
But the other shot that I remember is the mother walking out into the meadow to check to make sure everything's okay before Bambi comes out. And there's a shot where she puts her head up and her ears turn out, and it gives you this sense of alertness. And then the light and the fog and the color, it all gives this overwhelming sense of tranquility, but with danger. There's always something waiting. And I was thinking again today about Bambi goes through the grass and almost steps on a frog, and the frog says, "Watch out!"
Right. Yeah.
And I was just like, now who thought of that? Who thought, well, what does the frog should say something? What should the frog say? The frog says, "Watch out." What? Why is he saying, "Watch out, you almost stepped on me"? Or is he saying, just in general, you know,
"Watch out"?
Watch out.
Right.
Life is hard.
Danger is always afoot. Immediately afterwards, he meets Feline, who is a whole other kind of bucket of trouble for Bambi, because he has no idea what Feline wants. It's like everyone seems so much more up to speed than Bambi is. Like, Feline can't be older than him, but she's got so much more on the ball.
Right, exactly.
And she knows how to tease him. She knows how to wind him up. She knows how to dig at him.
And let's not forget to Twitter pay him.
Exactly. Yeah,
right. Well, it's definitely like I feel like it's a Disney trope of the female characters who are so much more interested in relationships than the male characters are, because we certainly get that here as these three young men are introduced to women for the first time, and they're all like, "Hell no, that's never happening to me." it happens. So
I especially like that. Yes, Thumper, who is a rabbit after all.
Right.
Has never shown the slightest interest in mating.
Exactly.
It's very funny. But yes, and it's not just that they're more interested in relationships. They're interested in sex. The rabbit is brushing her ear like a mermaid sitting on a rock. Mm-hmm. And she's got a little blush on her cheeks, and she's doing this kind of Veronica Lake thing, looking through her fur. They're all very seductive and way ahead of the game. And the men are just putty in their hands. "Oh, I there's nothing I can do about it."
I know.
So funny.
Andy,
you know what they say about Bambi? They say, "You think you saw Bambi. Wait till you see Bambi 2.
It may come across as a joke, but it is a sad reality that there is Bambi 2 out there in the world. This was that era when Disney decided to just, you know what, hey, let's just really dig into this sequel nonsense hardcore. And 2006, they actually put together Bambi 2, direct-to-video. And as Todd said, it is a period in the point when Bambi's mother has been shot, and it is about the great prince of the forest, as it says, struggling to raise the motherless Bambi, and Bambi's doubts about his father's love.
Oh my goodness.
Just what the world needed. And as if that wasn't enough, in 2020, they actually had announced that they were going to do a photorealistic CGI remake of Bambi. Paul Weitz and Chris Weitz, interestingly, both people who Todd has worked with, or I don't know, worked with, but certainly all ended up kind of getting credited on Ants as writers. They are on as producers for this. Now, it was in 2020 when they announced it with COVID and everything else that happened very shortly after that announcement. Nothing else has been said about that, so it's entirely possible that it's been dropped. Fingers crossed, that's the case.
Boy, Bambi's mother gets shot in photoreal. That's going to be great.
Oh, geez.
There's so many kids who are going to love that.
But, you know, just to be fair to the Disney company, Felix Salten, who wrote the original book, Bambi, A Life in the Woods, the German or the Austrian book, actually also wrote a sequel it would have been about 16 years after the publication of the original book. And it was called Bambi's Children and actually is about Bambi's kids growing up. So, you know, Disney's not the only one who was taking advantage of the popularity of the story.
I can't wait for Bambi 3, Deer in the City. You can see it now, can't you? Now, this was 1942. And I think the Oscars, the first Oscars were 1929. I'm pretty sure that's accurate. So by this point, were there enough good animated awards categories for something like Bambi to actually do well in the award season?
Yes, surprisingly. But it's one of those things where, you know, the Oscars, they didn't have as many categories as they do now. No best animated feature, things like that. But Bambi did get recognized, nominated for three categories: best scoring of a dramatic or comedy picture by Frank Churchill and Edward H. Plum, but lost to the film Now Voyager.
Hey.
The music by Max Steiner, which we've talked about on the next reel.
We've talked about.
Yeah. Love is a Song. Music by Frank Churchill, lyrics by Larry Morey, was nominated for Best Original Song, but lost to White Christmas from Holiday Inn, of course, by Irving Berlin. That's a hard one to argue. White Christmas, you know, it. I think it's fair to say it's pretty much a perennial classic.
Yeah.
And Best Sound Recording, C.O. Slyfield was nominated, but lost to Yankee Doodle Dandy, to Nathan Levinson for that film.
Yankee Doodle Dandy. Any other categories?
Interestingly, 1948, now this film was 1942, as you said, the Golden Globes, however, gave Walt Disney a special achievement award for furthering the influence of the screen for releasing a Hindustani version of the movie, which I think is interesting. It's like recognizing, hey, you know, this idea of other languages, that's not a bad idea. Good old Golden Globes.
They're catching up with the time.
Indeed. At the Hugo Awards, they weren't around at the time, but they started doing something a few years ago called the Retro Hugos. And they release awards, two films that are celebrating their, I think their 25th, 50th, or 75th anniversaries, or they're looking at years, those years. And so in the 75th anniversary categories in 2018, they awarded Bambi the Best Dramatic Presentation in Short Form, a win for the film.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's kind of interesting.
All right.
And then just two other points of note. AFI, you know, they're always releasing their top 10s or top 100s, and their 100 Years, 100 Heroes and Villains, they had Man from Bambi as the number 20 spot for the villains. And their top 10 for animated films, Bambi got number 3.
Okay, so turning our attention to the budget, normally when we go back this far, there isn't as much detail as you would like, as would satisfy your inner budgeting need. Did you get anything good on this one?
It's a tricky one. For Disney's fifth movie, you know, he had been losing money on several of his prior films, so he did have to cut the budget on this one, excising 12 minutes of the story, actually, and hence the 70-minute runtime here. That left the film with $858,000 to produce, which is about $16.2 million in today's dollars. The movie opened August 22, 1942, opposite the Pied Piper and Talk of the Town, as well as Pride of the Yankees, which had opened earlier in the week. Because this was opened during World War II, it really struggled at the box office, only earning about $1.3 million domestically. It did better on its first re-release in 1947, and it continued growing in popularity during its subsequent re-releases in 1957, 1966, 1975, 1982, and 1988. Throughout its series of releases, it ended up earning $168.2 million, or $267.4 million in today's dollars. That lands it with a handsome adjusted profit per finished minute of nearly $3.6 million. A slow start, but in the end, a great success.
You know, in terms of a comment on how we treat kids, how we think of kids, don't bore the kids. I sort of marvel at this movie where, you know, my son is like 17, he's going to be 17 in a month. And he sits down and looks at this movie and is absolutely riveted. Now, maybe if he were watching it with a bunch of other guys and they were doing guy things, he might not say it out loud.
Right.
But I think kids of all ages, whether they're, you know, 6, 16, or 50, they like cute. Like, it's okay to get lost in cute and adorable and beautiful and luxurious. It's okay to do that. And I think that's one of the things that I really celebrate. And this is a movie I did not watch very much. And I had to actually go back to my mother and say, what was my stance on Bambi? And she said that the fire scared the living daylights out of me. And I didn't watch it for like 10 years. Right. So I did not grow up with this movie. I kind of turned it off. And by the time I could have watched it again, I'd sort of moved on. So watching it again for this show is the first time I've watched it in many years. We didn't grow up with my kids in the house. Bambi was not in the catalog. It's an extraordinary experience. Extraordinary.
Yeah, absolutely.
I had a similar experience to you, Todd, where because I grew up with it as a kid, and then it was probably my early 20s or so, I watched it again. I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, it's a fine movie. And I didn't think about it again until I had kids. And then I was like, you know, I'm going to watch all, I went through the whole Disney chronology with my kids and watched all their films. And Bambi just hit me. And maybe it was because I had had kids at that point, but I just, it really struck me how there is so much, as you said, it's really about life and just kind of this journey of just kind of this ever constant process of being introduced to new things and changing things and adapting. And I don't know, it just really struck me with the way that the story was presented. So really a magical film.
And the sense that you never arrive anywhere. It's always a process. Is it possible to acquire wisdom, or is do you just get better at recognizing patterns? You know,
Like you said, absolutely.
And the idea that Bambi is now in the position of his father, and it's like, well, he went through all that, and now he can't be with his kids either. It's like you know, and there you are, and that's life. You don't learn anything. It all keeps changing. And anyway,
exactly. Well, I mean, it has been a fantastic conversation about just a wonderful, wonderful film. Thank you so much for bringing this film for us to discuss today. We certainly had a wonderful conversation with you.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Do you have a place out there online where you direct people as far as like what you're up to or kind of, you know, where you want people to go?
I have a blog that I update occasionally, toddalcott.com, where I talk about movies and TV shows. I'm on Facebook for if you want to see pictures of my cats, and also I'm working on a graphic novel, a memoir that I've been posting on Facebook as well. I'm there as Todd Alcott. Anyone who wants to follow me, I'm on Twitter and Instagram, and then I've got my Etsy store, Todd Alcott Graphics, where I sell my graphic work.
Well, we certainly appreciate you being here and talking with us about this movie. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you to all of our wonderful listeners out there for tuning in. For all of you out there, we hope you like the show and certainly hope you like the movie like we do here on Movies We Like. The Next Reel presents Movies We Like is a part of the True Story FM Entertainment Podcast Network. The music is Chonk Clap by Out of Flux. Find the show at truestory.fm and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Letterboxd at The Next Reel. If your podcast app allows ratings and reviews, hey, we always appreciate it if you drop one in there for us. See you next time.
Andy, can you believe we've almost hit 700 episodes of The Next Reel?
I know, it's crazy. And with all the other episodes in our family of podcasts, we are well over 1,200 episodes of movie conversation. It's really pretty amazing that we've gotten to have these in-depth movie chats every week for over a decade now.
And we couldn't have done it without our loyal community of film fans. Their support over the years has meant so much.
For sure. That reminds me, we should give the merch store a shout out. Buying shirts from thenextreel.com/merch is a great way listeners can continue to support the show. Plus, they get to sport our great designs.
Absolutely. I think sometimes folks forget we have a variety of shirts, mugs, phone cases, and more available. In fact, a great place to start is with a shirt sporting The Next Reel's logo.
We also have that classic Fast Times Spicoli Surf School tee, or the weirdly popular Rusty's European Tour shirt.
The one from National Lampoon's European Vacation. Why is that so popular?
Search me, but we have sold a ridiculous number of those. I guess there are a lot of Rusty's taking trips to Europe?
We're always adding new designs based on movies we've covered, like our brand new design for A Streetcar Named Desire, featuring a streetcar named Desire. So if you want to rep your love of TNR and films, head to thenextreel.com/merch.
Every purchase helps us continue to have these weekly in-depth conversations. So visit thenextreel.com/merch today.
And as always, thanks for listening and being a part of the Next Reel community. We've got lots more great movie chats coming your way.
I love having these wonderful chats on movies we like with all these industry guests talking about some of their favorite movies.
So many great conversations on that show about so many great movies.
We have so much fun having these conversations, but producing the show week after week does require a lot of work behind the scenes. If you'd like to help support our efforts, one easy way is by using our originals page when shopping for books and movies that we've covered.
Your purchases made through our links give us a small commission at no extra cost to you and allow us to keep having these incredible conversations.
The originals page at thenextreel.com/originals links to the source material for all the adapted film discussions on The Next Reel's family of podcasts. Purchasing through our links supports the show.
It's your one-stop shop for Amazon and Apple links where you can buy your copy of the original source material.
Original material for movies like Casino Royale,
The Silent Partner,
Never Let Me Go,
Silver Linings Playbook,
There Will Be Blood, based on Upton Sinclair's Oil.
I believe it's Oil!
Oh, yeah. I forgot the exclamation point.
Plus, by using those links to buy your next read, Apple and Amazon show us a little bit of love, which allows you to support our family of shows with minimal effort.
TheNextReel.com/originals. It's a great way to support the show and find your next page turner.
That's right. Head over to TheNextReel.com/originals to pick out your next read and dig in today.